Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be looking at Chapter 3 of Pragmatic Programmer, which is called The Basic Tools. It's about the concept of getting acclimated to the things that we use in our day-to-day lives and how they and we adapt to each other so that eventually the tools are extensions of our minds in that they express our thoughts and ideas. The most basic tool we have to work with is none other than plain text. Nothing is more simple and effective at capturing our ideas and imposing them on the world than through the written word. That said, writing isn't inherently useful, as it also has to be meaningful to readers, whether human or machine. Part of being understandable is being structured. That might mean in terms of forming letters into words, words into sentences, or formats such as JSON, YAML, HTML, and so on. Being structured is important because it allows us to interact with the text, which is the ultimate goal of that text in the first place. This applies to books, YouTube scripts, and computer programs, though the latter are meant to be interpreted by a machine, while the former are meant to be interpreted by people like you and me. There is a lot of overlap in coding, however, as what we write has to be understood by both humans and machines, or at least the compiler of a machine. And so there's an extra layer of distinction between what we could call human-readable, quote-unquote, and human-understandable, quote-unquote. This is important because just because you see letters that are recognizable doesn't mean that what you're looking at is understandable. Therefore, you should strive to write code that makes sense to other people as well, not just to yourself, and not just to the machines that the code will be running on. One thing that makes code easier to understand is testability, which is something I've talked about a lot in other videos. And this basically stems from the fact that a test has to be looking for one piece of behavior to verify, and the easier that behavior is to identify, the easier it can be tested, and thus the easier it can be understood by others. So it's kind of a circular or self-fulfilling logistical contract, if that makes sense. The easier something can be tested, the easier it can be understood, and vice versa. The next section is called shell games, and it's about the importance of using your terminal, or command shell. This is an interface to telling your machine to execute specific commands that it should execute. That might entail git commands, cron jobs, and innumerable other things. Now that computer engineering is a mature field, there are graphical user interface tools to accomplish most of the things that you'd like to without having to learn the text commands. The authors refer to these as WYSIWYG tools. It's an acronym. What you see is what you get. This is convenient since you have easy access to a lot of commands without having to learn them. But the dark side of WYSIWYG is that what you see is all you get. And that means unnecessary limitations on what you can do. By contrast, with terminal commands, your imagination will be exhausted before the terminal's capabilities are. It just requires more learning up front. The next section is called power editing, and the authors state that tools should be an extension of your hand. I'd even go one step further and say that the tools should be an extension of your mind via your hands. The truth is that if your thoughts aren't manifesting on screen at the speed you're having them, then you have a bottleneck somewhere and need to fix it to improve your productivity. Sometimes that would mean something like getting a faster computer that can handle running computationally intensive programs without slowing down. Sometimes that will mean practicing typing to be faster and more accurate. Sometimes that will mean installing productivity apps like Spectacle for window management, so that you can navigate between apps and organize them in such a way that what you need to have access to, be it a reference, be it your code base, be it your terminal, is only a keystroke away. Sometimes it will mean just getting more and more proficient with the programs that you use, like an IDE or other text editor, so that your code looks as beautiful as you imagined it would be through the use of linters, syntax highlighting, auto imports, import alphabetization automatically, and a million other things that reduce the barriers to your productivity. Version control is next. The vast majority of the world uses Git to keep track of change in a code base and retain the ability to revert to old versions of the code in case bugs are introduced. There are basically two different kinds of Git users in the world, librarians and surgeons. You can tell the former from the latter, as the librarians are obsessed with clean record keeping and not messing up the commit history. On the other hand, surgeons care less about the process and more so about the content. They're able to find where bugs were introduced or what changes are having a particular effect on the current state of the application, and are more concerned with that than record keeping. The difference is akin to people who believe paperwork and processes are ultimately the product of their effort, versus ones who believe them to be a side effect and that the code itself is the product or some other aspect of the business is truly the business. At a minimum, you should be comfortable with making branches and pull requests, giving and receiving code reviews from teammates, and adding remotes so that it's easier for you to be a productive member in the team. However, there are quite a few other Git commands that are worth knowing, and you can look into them as you need them or as you're curious or as applicable. Now, this leads naturally into the next section, which is about debugging. I often give interviews where I ask people about how they would identify misbehavior on a website. And in dozens of times of asking, very few think to look at the code to see what's changed recently. If your code was working and now isn't working for some reason, one of the absolute first things you need to do is see what's changed lately. Being a Git surgeon is incredibly helpful for this. If you can identify when in a particular day you started seeing misbehavior in the program or the website, you can look at what changes were committed to the code base around that time, and that will narrow down the universe of your entire code base to probably just a handful of files. If you don't know when the misbehavior was introduced, a command like git bisect will help narrow down for you when the culprit came about. I want to point out something about human nature here, which is that making mistakes is part of being human. No one is perfect, and so when you mess up, it's important to take responsibility as soon as possible so that the bug can be rectified and moved on from. Hopefully you work at a company that doesn't blame or punish people for making mistakes, but if they do, it's worth balancing with that in mind. Other helpful ideas for debugging are things like rubber ducking, quote unquote, which is the idea that you understand something better when explaining it to others, such as a literal or metaphorical rubber duck. One other thing that's helpful is taking a look at logs to see where errors appear. Debugging is such a massively important skill to have as a programmer, and if you don't have a personal strategy for the type of bugs you encounter the most, I would recommend thinking through and developing one. So that's all for this video. Thanks for spending some time here. Although I make these videos purely for enjoyment, for education, and for free, if you did find these ideas thought-provoking and helpful, I would appreciate a like and your subscription, and I'll see you all in the next one.